Hi, I'm Brenda Buglione, standing on the top of beautiful Vail Mountain. Welcome to a new season of SnowMotion. Today we're going to introduce you to two former world-class skiers, Phil and Steve Mahre, twin brothers that have a combined 36 World Cup wins and 3 Olympic medals. Next, we're going to meet mogul skier Hannah Kearney, and then I'm going to give you my ski tip, and we're going to find out how close our skis should be together. Stay with us, you're watching SnowMotion.
Would it be easier if we had no shoes, no time to kill, and nothing to lose, and no worries but the great blue sky? And looking for shade when the sun gets high, yeah, climbing up that coconut tree. If it's time for one of nature's treats, would it be easier?
It's a place where I feel at home. Every run is an adventure. Vail, it's like nothing on earth.
SnowMotion is brought to you by The New Mitch by Paul Mitchell. Style isn't born, it's groomed. And by Surefoot. Better fitting, better skiing. We rode up the chairlift on Vail Mountain with Phil and Steve Mahre. They're not only twins, but they're fierce competitors. They had a lot to say. Let's hear from Phil first. This week's SnowMotion chairlift interview is with the Mahre brothers. On this chairlift, we have Phil Mahre. Phil, I have so many questions for you because you've had such an amazing career. 30 years ago, you won the gold medal in Sarajevo.
Right. I can't believe it's 30 years ago. It's more than half a lifetime.
Let's change that. Let's say 15. You and your brother have done so much for the sport of ski racing for so long. Tell us about that moment, though, 30 years ago.
You know, I really resigned myself to a silver medal after the first run. Steve led the first run. I think I was 7/10 behind him, and that's an eternity in slalom skiing, so I pretty much given up hope on a gold. I knew we were a gold and silver medalist as long as we finished without mistakes the second run. And fortunately for me, he made 3 mistakes, and I overtook him by 2100s to win the gold medal. But you know, it really changed the way I look at my whole career. Prior to that, it was always me. I did this, I accomplished this. And when I won my gold medal there, I thought that was going to be the same thing. I'd go to the awards ceremony. Hey, look what I did. It wasn't the case at all. You start to hear your national anthem play, and it's not just yours, it's America's. You see your flag being raised to the highest stanchion, and all the thoughts go through your mind, you know, that's just not my flag. And coaches, family, friends, teammates, they're all on that podium with you. And it really changed the way I look at my whole career. Prior to that, it was all about me, and after that, I realized that there was a lot of people in my corner, and had that not been for America, my Olympic dream would have never happened.
Oh, that's really nice to have. See the big picture and be so grateful.
You have to be. You know, you don't get anywhere on your own. Obviously, you put in a lot of hard work, but there's a lot of people that work hard to really let you do what you love to do.
So it's a team.
It's all a team.
Do you feel that having a twin pushed you both? It seems like it did.
Oh, yeah. I mean, you know, he retired after the 76 season and was going to, you know, go back to school, figure out what he wanted to do with the rest of his life. And I decided to ski through 1980, Lake Placid. And you know, I won my first race the very next season in December. Steve was at home. He's like, I can beat him. And so he came out of retirement and we raced together.
Of course he could.
Raced together for 8 more years. Had he not come back, I would have made it to 80. I don't know if I would have stayed around for 84. Would I have been as successful as I was without him there? I don't know. That's hard to say. We push one another without even knowing we push one another.
I know you do. I see it.
Yeah.
Even in
we're competitive. But we always have a saying, keep in the family. And then, you know, if I couldn't win, then I'd like to see him win and vice versa. So but there were training days when, you know, I'd be watching him skiing so fast. And I'd be like, boy, you got to get going, Phil. And he'd be watching me that same day going, man, Phil's skiing fast. I got to get going. So without really even having a clock on one another, we knew or we pushed one another. And it was great to have a partner like that to train with, to really push or compare yourself to and also push yourself with. And then the other thing was to have him as a roommate on the tour. Nothing like blood. And, you know, if you have family issues or personal issues, you can talk to your brother about those. I don't know if I could have done that with a teammate.
So you've had this incredible ski racing career together, and now you're still working together with your camps. Tell us about your camps.
We'll always work together. Steve and I are more of a pair than we are as individuals, but our camps are Mahre training centers. We started the year after we retired. We went to Keystone, Colorado, and we did camps there for 20 years, and we just moved to Deer Valley 10 years ago. We do 5 a year, 2 in December, 2 in January, 1 in February usually. It's a skiing enhancement program for all levels, all abilities. Our typical clients, 35 to 55 in age and intermediate in ability. But we have never evers, and we have people that skied for 30 or 40 years. We work with the Deer Valley Ski School, and then we have coaches we pull out of their ski school to help us with our camps. But Steve and I ski a half a day with every group there. And if we can, we'll double up with people. It just depends on how many groups we have. But like in a 5-day camp, there's 10 groups. I can get through all of them. Steve can get through all of them. And so, you know, if we have fewer than 10, then they'll see me for a full day.
It's pretty special.
You know, when you see light bulbs go on for people their skiing, that's what brings you out and brings you back. And I love working with people. I love meeting people. And more importantly, I hopefully pass on the passion that I have for the sport, as does Steve, to people, you know, out on the hill.
I feel the same, and I relate to that so much, because you get so much satisfaction of someone challenging themselves and getting it and enjoying themselves even more.
Exactly. Yeah. You know, to this day, I still have a passion for the sport. I love to go out and ski, and you know, you just go out and have fun. Put a smile on your face and enjoy it.
Okay, so I would like to know why you guys were so great. Your reputation was that you trained harder than anyone else.
Well, I mean, we were kind of workaholics. So I think we learned that from our dad. We were usually the first one on the hill, last one off the hill. In dry land, you know, we'd stay an extra 15 or 20 minutes, just my brother and I, and do wind sprints or something after everybody else had been, you know, quit. Talent will take you so far, but it's hard work that takes you the rest of the way. And a lot of kids have a lot of talent, but they don't have the determination, the desire, and the drive from within to take them to the next level. And that's frustrating, because
to watch that.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. It's frustrating to watch that, because there's a lot of people that have a great talent, and it just doesn't seem to come to the surface the way it should.
What would you tell a young ski racer that has aspirations to be one of the best?
Well, the biggest thing is to have fun. You have to love what you're doing, have a passion for what you're doing. And then it's, you have to work harder than everybody else, and you have to be willing to try new things. But you also have to know yourself well enough to make decisions for yourself. It's your career, and you have to make the decisions for your career that you feel are best suited for you. And a lot of times, you know, kids are asking for an answer versus trying to find that answer.
Give me
themselves.
An example. What do you mean? A decision that how many training runs, or what skis they're using, or camps they're going to go to?
Whether you're going to go to a camp in the summer or whether you're going to stay home. Steve and I gave up ski camps to play high school football. I said, you know, I can play high school football for 4 years. I can ski race the rest of my life. And so we gave up the opportunity to go skiing and play football. But there were times in Europe when I say, okay, there's 2 races left in December. I'm skiing terrible. I should just go home and take an extra week at home and do my own training.
And to have that maturity to make those decisions, which are harder really than, it's harder to leave, you know, than to stay there.
Yep, it is.
Okay, well, this is Phil, and now the next Chairlift ride is gonna be with Steve. Hang in there.
Good luck.
Don't go away. When we come back to SnowMotion, we'll talk to Phil's twin brother, Steve.
What we've done at Surefoot is really changed the way that you get ski boots. The sun shines bright. This boot is made for your foot. The difference is amazing. You'll ski better, They're better fitting, better skiing than anything you've ever experienced.
I woke up feeling great. Today was made for me. And life is good the way it should.
In 2009, High Fives was formed to help athletes that have suffered a life-altering injury return to the sport they love.
He said, "Whatever you need, we'll help you make happen."
To become a member or to help support the cause, go to highfivesfoundation.org.
Welcome back to Snow Motion. Now it's time to find out what Steve Mahre has to say. Part two of today's chairlift interview is with Steve Mahre. Can you tell him apart?
Only because I have a blue coat on.
This is Phil. Who's better, you or Phil?
Well, we always have a joke. I'm a better coach, he's a better skier. Hence the gold and the silver. You know, if I wouldn't have been coaching me, I would have beat him. I'm a better coach. So
because you helped coach him to the gold.
Yes,
and
exactly.
Helped him.
And he's always said, yeah, or I taught him everything he knows, but not everything I know. Phil says that as well, hence the gold and silver. We have a good time with it.
I think you're better looking, so why don't we?
Yeah, there we go. Give me five on that one.
I just learned a little bit about the Mahre Training Center.
Yeah.
How would someone join or be able to come ski with you? How do they find out about it?
Go to MahreTrainingCenter.com, yeah. The website, and get the information you need there to get a hold of the Deer Valley Ski School, which is where they end up enrolling and whatnot.
That would be a great treat for someone to do.
Yes, it would be. I mean, you should come and do it one day.
Maybe I can get better. Well, I was thinking last weekend when we were all racing together at the American Ski Classic, you guys are really the ones that still give yourself room at the top of the gate. Your technique is always good.
That's Harold, our old coach, in the back of our head still. You know, he was so mean during our career that it's just beat into us, you know. Whenever we get engaged, it's like, okay, Harold, I'm trying to be on your line.
But you're looking at the course, you take it seriously. I love that. And you set up.
Not near as seriously as I used to.
That's true.
But believe me, from start to finish, I don't like to lose.
No, I know that. I
None
don't
of
either.
Us do, I guess.
I was just out of control, but it's so fun.
Yes, it is. Yep.
But I was thinking I need to set up a little more like you do and have the patience.
Well, it's funny because I think I skied the best I have probably in 3 or 4 years there this year. And my biggest thing was to keep the hips down and get the foot out so it can come back to me. And so some of the old things came back to me.
It's so much fun.
Yes, it
Why
is.
Could we keep on working on it? What's our limit? When we're 80, that's when we'll stop? Or do you think we'll still pass?
No, you know, I don't think you will. I mean, we had a lady that worked with our training centers because we were in Keystone for 20 years. And then we moved to Deer Valley 10 years ago. And we had a lady that was helping us coach Ina Gillis.
Yeah, that's right, in
Keystone. And we just skied with her about, 10 days ago or something. And she's 90 now, basically, and unbelievable. She still slides great out there. We had a lot of fun with it. So I say, if I can be doing that at 90, I'll be a happy man.
All of us, right?
Yes.
Okay, now, after you won a medal in Sarajevo, and that's been 30 years ago,
Yeah. Tell
us what life is like after being an Olympian.
Well, yeah, they say always an Olympian. Once an Olympian, always an Olympian. But I think, you know, we had a great career, Phil and I did, and that made it possible for us to make a living in the ski industry. So this is kind of my backyard still, or my office as well, and I love doing that. But the summer months are kind of free to do what we want. And a couple years ago, I built my own house. My older brother, Davey, and myself did probably about 85% of it. Phil came over and helped some, and brother-in-laws and sons and whatever, you know, other relatives and whatnot once in a while when we needed big projects to get done. But we spent basically a year and a half doing that, and so enjoy doing that. Still ride motocross for fun.
And you
water
competed,
skiing.
Right? Didn't you compete?
Race
car driving.
Well, we did some of that for a number of years, then we quit, and then we did a little more, and now we're building a race car at home right now, a chump car. It's a cheap man's racing. They say the car can't be worth more than $500. And then they're all endurance races, 12, 24.
You guys are
24.
Just big kids. That's what you are.
Yep.
And it's race car, building houses.
Go-karting, motocross, yeah. Water skiing. Phil built his own water ski lake below his house years ago. So yeah, just the summer months are free to do what we love to do, other things. And so we continue to do that.
Why, I asked Phil this, why were you so good? What do you think?
Well, one would be him. Had I not had him, I don't think I would have had the success, because we pushed one another from the time we were very young. If I wasn't, had he not been there, when we were 8 and 9, we were winning races by 2 or 3, maybe 4 seconds between the third place guy, and we'd be close to first and second. And so had he not been there those years, I would have done just enough to beat the other kids instead of having to push to beat him. And so that helped a bunch, I think. And then, we come from a big family, so we learned competition at the dinner table. With 9 kids in our family and whatnot. But I think that was the biggest thing. And then, once we made the ski team, Harold Schoenhaar from Germany really saw the potential that we had and just corrected a lot of more tactical mistakes than technical mistakes. Got us on a better tactical line and stuff in gates, and just kind of kept refining our techniques and quiet down the upper body, using too much energy, and that got us where we got. It's funny because so many people say, oh, you worked hard. I said, no, I just played a lot. Yeah, I played every day I went out there.
I just said that. People say that the Mahres were so good because they worked harder. They skied more.
Yeah, well, we did that. I think
and
we
played harder.
We put more hours in. We did a lot more gates than most of the other kids, because that's what ski racing is, going around gates, not free skiing. But on the long run, it's just something that it came easy. I mean, we were all, from the time we were, well, Phil made the team when he was 15. I made it when I was 16. But it just came easy. And there never seemed to be a spot where I ever went backwards in my career. I mean, one time I went to the national level, immediately started, within 2 or 3 years, was winning at the national level, then went to the world level, and within 3 years, was winning there. And so it just came easy, it seemed like.
What would you tell a young racer right now that wants to have aspirations like you?
Well, you can't think, if you ever feel like you sacrificed something else to do this, then you don't love it enough to get good at it.
You gotta love it.
Yep, you gotta love it.
From Phil and Steve, thanks for the rides. Here we go.
You bet.
We love finding new ski and snowboard movies and watching big mountain riders do their thing. Check out this week's hot video clip.
So the Freeride World Tour is this unique situation where you only get to look at the face from afar and then sometimes above. So instead of getting to poke around in there, seeing how the snow is, see what stuff looks like up close, you're just looking at it through binoculars, sometimes from 100, 1,000 yards away. And how big those cliffs are, how good that snow is, it's all just a guess. And that really affects the way you choose your line and the way you assess a face.
Visual only inspection is a huge part of the sport, and it's definitely overlooked by a lot of the public that aren't real familiar with what we do. A lot of people think we go out and just blindly throw ourselves down a mountain. In actuality, people are really calculated. People have chosen a line with incredible precision.
Yeah, the face looks completely different from the top compared to seeing the opposite side of the valley. It's like it's a completely different mountain.
My first year on the tour, we were in the finals in Verbier, and I had perhaps the gnarliest line I've ever picked out in a contest. And I remember this is like the biggest event I've ever been in, just so nervous, and there's so much pressure going on in this. And I had built a name for myself in the US, but I hadn't had much success in Europe competing. And I remember at this run, I was like, the judges are gonna remember me after this run. I'm gonna like really go for it. I'm here to win it. Just the entire production with the helicopters and the media, it's like no other contest in the world. And that just, gives you both these nerves and this drive to try something that, might be way out of your element. And I had sized it up and I thought I was good to go. And I got up there, I hit my first air and it was good. And then I remember I got to this next feature and it was just this blind takeoff, didn't look right at all. And like, literally it was just a horizon line, and I had no idea if I was lined up with this patch of snow, but I went for it anyway. That moment when you don't know where you are is one of the most dangerous moments, not only for your score, but just for your personal safety, because as soon as you start skiing a face with no reference to anything else, you don't know if you're going off that 10-foot rollover or that 100-foot rollover at the bottom. And I teed off, landed on this middle pillow, back slapped, went cat out the window, off the second air, and ended up landing on my back, breaking my thumb, and it was just a super scary moment because, you know, you lose it and there's all this pressure in the moment where you think that, you know, this is, no matter what, you have to go for it, and you take these chances, especially when you're young and inexperienced. And, you know, I was lucky to come out of it only with a broken thumb. It could have been way worse. Even the judges afterwards came up to me and were like, you know, what were you thinking? To never set foot on that face and to be able to charge it like you've skied it 100 times, that's something that's truly special to just a few people on the tour.
Don't go anywhere. There's more Snow Motion on the way. We'll see you on the other side of the break.
It's a place where I feel at home. Every run is an adventure. Vail, it's like nothing on earth.
What we've done at Surefoot has really changed the way that you get ski boots.
The sun shines bright.
This boot is made for your foot. The difference is amazing. You'll ski better. They're better fitting, better skiing than anything you've ever experienced.
I woke up feeling great. Today was made for me. And life is good the way it should.
In 2009, HiFi's was formed to help athletes that have suffered a life-altering injury return to the sport they love.
Said whatever you need, we'll help you make happen.
To become a member or to help support the cause, go to highfivesfoundation.org.
SnowMotion is brought to you by Vail, like nothing on earth, and by Bogner, the luxury of sport. For more SnowMotion fun, log on to my website at snow-motion.com. Today's ski tip is about stands. How far should your skis really be apart? Well, it's based on the conditions that you're going to ski. When you're skiing the groomers or steeper terrain, you want your skis about hip width apart. You need to give yourself room so you can roll your edges over and carve your turns. If I was skiing the groomers with my skis close together, there's no room to get my downhill ski up on edge to carve. You have more weight on your downhill ski than your uphill ski. It's about 80% on the downhill ski, 20% on the uphill ski, or 70-30. But you need that power on that downhill ski to carve, so you need to roll it over. When you're skiing the powder, the bumps, the crud, you want your skis close together. You don't have to have room to put the ski up on edge because you're skiing with your skis close and as a unit. If you were skiing the powder and the bumps, and you had all your weight on your downhill ski and no weight on your uphill ski, the uphill ski is easy to catch snow and make you fall. You want about 60% on your downhill ski, 40% on the weight on the uphill ski. You're pressing down into the turn and you release up with your skis together over the crud and the bumps and the powder and then back down. So remember, you adjust your stance with the conditions that you're gonna ski. So if you're gonna ski those steep groomers, you want to open up your stance so you can lay that edge over and carve your turns. If you're going to be in the bumps, the powder, the crud, you want to bring your stance close together so you can ski as one unit. What's left to accomplish after winning a gold medal in the Winter Olympic Games? We had a chance to catch up with Hannah Kearney, and she told us what her eyes are set on now.
My first memories of skiing come in little glimpses, like a dream. I remember being on the side of a trail and loving the little paths that cut around the trees that my parents couldn't fit through because they were only meant for little kids. As soon as I started taking freestyle skiing lessons when I was 7, I loved the sport. But it was not until I was 16 years old and qualified for the US ski team that I thought this may actually be my future. My experience in Vancouver was one I will never forget. And although I wear a US ski team uniform at every competition, it's at the Olympics where you truly are representing every single citizen of the United States and your country up against every other country in the world.
She's done it! American Hannah Carney wins gold!
I know I still have more in me. I feel like I'm close to my athletic peak. I'm a very veteran competitor at this point. I love being in the start gate, but I think I can push myself. You gotta win every morning when you wake up, even when the weather's crummy or you feel sore, you kind of feel sick. You have to make the decisions that make you a champion on the hill when you're off of it.
Thanks for watching this edition of Snow Motion. I'm Brenda Buglione, and we'll see you in the Bat Bowls of Vail, Colorado.
Would it be easier if we had no shoes, no time to kill, and nothing to lose, and no worries but the great blue sky? And looking for shade when the sun gets high, yeah, climbing up that coconut tree. If it's time for all of nature's treats, would it be easier?